You see the handprints on the screen. I love the looks of this, and you can go online, you can pick up some other pictures of handprints on walls. When we moved, or while we were in Virginia, in the area when we did an expansion, because we were in the mountains, and so you could even have a basement that was a walkout basement. So we built a new building that had a gymnasium, and then under it was a full-size gym space plus some other area. So it was larger than a regulation gym, and it had a front door coming out onto the ground level in the parking lot below. When you walked into that area, it was the youth area, the new youth area. When you walked in, immediately to your right, there was a booth for check-in and that kind of thing. And the youth pastor at the time, we had painted everything basically white, probably Easy 8 if Terry Koch had anything to do with it, kind of an off-white. And on that wall, he had all the youth that were in the youth department to put their hands in paint, different colors. They could choose their color and put their handprint on the wall and date and put their name on it. You know, I thought it was a neat-looking wall. I wish several times over the last 15 years, I wish when I had come here I'd have thought to take that same concept and get up here in the wall behind the baptistry, and as everyone that was baptized in the during that time, they would put their hand in paint and put it on the wall, and we would put their name and the date they were baptized, a testimony to their salvation. I thought about it 15 years after the thing. So, but you know, I got to thinking this last week, if we were to do that based on our average baptisms over the last 15 years, we'd have a couple of 100 to 300 handprints on that wall. Everybody's handprint is different. And it's different on purpose. Okay? Now I want you to take that idea of handprints, and then we're going to apply it to the church in a little different way. I want you to think about First Baptist Church Iowa Park and her pastors and ministers over the years. Think of the handprints that have been left. When it comes to senior pastors, prior to me, the church has had 32 pastors in 114 years. That's from 1890 to 2004. If you do the math, that tells you that the average handprint being left by pastors, 3.5 years. You say, wow, that's not long. Well, that's pretty well the Southern Baptist average. That's frightening when they tell us that you don't really get to know the people until 5 years. And the people don't really get to know you until you've been there 5 years. So 3.5 years average. Well, I came, and it's been a little longer than that. But I want to think for a second about those guys that have come before me. Their unique handprints. Every one of those ministers has come in here and put their handprints and their heart prints on the church. The reason First Baptist Church is what it is today is because of those many prints that have been left. One of the first things I was told when I went to seminary and we were looking at leaving seminary and going out and going into the ministry, they said, guys, do not forget the Holy Spirit doesn't show up when you get there. The Holy Spirit was already there and already working and had been doing great and mighty things before you ever showed up. In many cases, before, I might be old, but I'm not this old. In many cases, before I was born. Many handprints. Each handprint represented an individual who was gifted and excelled in one way or another. And those of you that have been around here for a while, you can look back at some pastors and go, he was great at this. And he wasn't too good at that, and this one was great at this, but not too good at that. But they each had their special handprints to leave on this church. They each had their own personalities and their giftedness, and they excelled in something. The truth is, each pastor has helped in one way or another to make this church what it is today. In 2004, when I came as the 33rd senior pastor, I had those you remember there used, some of you remember there used to be a board that sat here with all the names and all the dates and all of that. It's over in the chapel now. But for the last 15 years, I've been leaving these sets of handprints on the church. And sometimes we've celebrated some successes, and there have been times that we've just said, you know what? We blew it. Let's scrap that idea and start over again. A couple of interesting notes. When I passed the 10-year mark, I became the longest tenured pastor of the church. Now at 15 years, I've blown the curve. Don't you like those guys? You know, when you're taking a test and somebody makes a 100 and they're grading on the curve, you want to just get rid of that guy because he just blew the curve for you. But First Baptist Iowa Park is in a very interesting place. When you look at not just my tenure, but the tenure of the ministerial staff here. Because when you look at those that are not senior pastor and you look at those that are associate ministers in the church, the average tenure for them is less than 2 years. But you look at our staff, and Jennifer's been here, I wrote it down, 9 years. Josh has been here 7 years. Trent's been here 4.5 years. And if you throw Judy in the mix, she just, you'd have to talk about BJ before Judy. You know, she's been here so long. So we've broken the norm with all of our staff. We're all much more tenured than the average in the Southern Baptist Convention, and that's a good thing. Now, our church is also unique in the fact that Jennifer and Josh and Trent all came out of this church. Not many churches can say that. You say, well, is that a good thing? Absolutely, it's a good thing. Listen, we're supposed to be making disciples, right? I don't think a church is totally successful if they're just seeing baptisms. That's an important gauge. That's an important marker. But we ought to be seeing people called to ministry in the church. And so we've got folks not only that were called into ministry, so we were seeing that discipling process work out in some lives, but guess what? God did this amazing thing, and now they're serving in the church that they came out of. I know of a pastor that we used to serve, be a member of his church when we were in Texarkana, and he became a pastor in his hometown. He said, man, I had to go back and start apologizing to some people. He said, oh, brother so-and-so owned the grocery store, and I had to go apologize for stealing apples because now I'm his pastor. And so sometimes being a minister in your hometown is difficult. Jesus even talked about that. But we're unique in that situation, and I love it. I think it's a biblical way to do things, if at all possible. But you take the 33 senior pastors and you add the numerous associate pastors, youth ministers, ministers of music, children's ministers, and on and on and on, and you have a massive number of handprints left on the church that we know as First Baptist Church Iowa Park. Now, when you're following one of those people, you're one of those subsequent staff members, you have some things you need to live up to. You have to live down some things, because you'll hear things like, well, oh, brother so-and-so, you know, he was so good at this. For me, it was, well, you know, brother so-and-so, he preached about 15 or 20 minutes. That's not even a good devotion in my mind. I made a statement when I came, something about sermonettes for Christianettes, and I offended Buddy Burns, who was the interim, because he said, you're talking about me. Well, okay, shoe fits. But we have to live down some things that people really like. There are other things that pastors and staff members before us that really made some messes that the church is looking at us and going, afraid you're going to be just like him. So we've had to live down some bad things. But that's just the way it is. Now, let me also say that churches leave their handprints on staff members. Okay? Some good and some not so good, just saying. So it goes both ways, guys. The picture of the handprints. There you go. The picture of the handprints shows building. Shows many people involved in the building of the church. But it's also a picture of change. You see, for one handprint to be put there and then another hand, that means somebody's leaving, somebody's coming, and there's some change in that process. And so when you see those handprints, you think of things that are there and has been there, and then you and change is a good thing. Listen, the alternative to that is death. So change is a good thing. So now I want you to think of those handprints and then think about leadership in the church and leadership changes. In the Baptist church, we are what, and we're proud of it, we are autonomous. You know what that means? Nobody tells us what to do. As I go around and talk to churches for the state convention, I'll say, we're not here to tell you what to do, because something I learned a long time ago, you can't tell a Baptist what to do. And so we're not here for that. We're here to walk alongside you. And so that means that there's no hierarchy telling us how we do stuff. There are some guidelines. There are some theological things we need to agree with. But it's how we do the operation of the church. We choose our own way. How we handle vacancies on staff is ultimately up to us. Now, it ought to, if it's an issue that the Bible speaks to, we need to stick with Scripture. Okay? And there's some things like what color the carpet is. The Bible doesn't care. God really doesn't care what color the carpet is. He's okay with taking the carpet out. Okay? It doesn't matter to him. It's what we do. But if the Bible speaks to something, we need to make sure we follow the biblical instruction. And then we also have our operation documents that we need to be aware of and deal with. But ultimately, the idea of a congregational church is the church gets to choose. We choose what we do, and we choose how we do it. Well, over a year ago, I was reading and studying, and in that process, it seemed like I kept coming across articles, and my attention kept being drawn into one area. It was as if God were saying, you've led faithfully for all these years, you've led through various changes, so why would you not lead the church through the process of leadership transition? Why would you not help the church to see there's more than one way to do it? Now, I'm going to give you some numbers here in a few minutes, and the numbers I'm going to give you are for senior pastors, because I could pull numbers for youth pastors and children's ministers and all those things, but we need one place just to get the picture, and so I'm going to use senior pastors. That's the most easily available. In an article on May the 1st of 2017, a Baptist article in one of our Baptist papers, it said full-time churches have more senior pastors who are over 65 than under 40. In the past quarter century, American pastors, number one, have moved from the median age of 44 to 54. And they have tripled in over 65 age group from 6 to almost 18%. Now, you can read that any way you want to. It just means some of us are getting old. Okay? The pastors are getting older, and that goes for other positions. I mean, today we're seeing youth pastors that are 50 years old, and used to, if you got past about 25 or 30, they said you're too old to be one. But ministers are aging. Now, we can look at that and go, okay, well, what is it today? That's 2017. I'll tell you, the trends continue in the same direction. Is there anything wrong with older ministers? No. Is there anything wrong with younger ministers? No. It's just part of the process. So with these stats and others, we see that in the next 5 to 10 years, there's going to be many pastors and ministers retiring. And at this point, I'm not confident, based on what we're seeing in our seminaries, that there is being enough ministers trained to replace the ones that are retiring. Because less guys are going into ministry. And that's a whole nother subject to deal with. Now, there's nothing that I can do or you can do to change the trend. Okay? in and of ourselves. There's nothing that we can do to get the seminaries to produce more pastors other than to encourage people to go into ministry. But that's going to take time. But there are some things that I believe we can do that will help here and help this area, and maybe even hopefully set an example for some other churches. And so that's what I want to talk to you about. So how do churches normally handle Southern Baptist churches when a pastor leaves? Well, the pastor resigns, and this could be for another staff member, but they resign. The church gets some guys to preach or to fill in from week to week, pulpit supply or whatever you want to call it. The church forms a search committee. The committee identifies and recommends, and the church approves an interim who is a little more stable than the day week to week. The search committee then begins to meet and pray and gather and sort resumes and interview candidates and settles on a candidate based on their resume, which I always tell people is kind of like dating. You know, you don't see everything. I found out some, let me change it. Jerry found out some things about me that didn't show up on my dating resume, okay? There were some things that she was shocked about when we got married, and we dated for a long time. But I was intentionally covering some things up so I'd get her. That's a resume purpose. They look at references, and they hear them preach a sermon or maybe two. Now, I'm not discounting the fact that the Holy Spirit is involved. That is understood. Then the church meets the candidate and his family. They hear him preach once, and then they vote to call him or not. And when they say, yes, we're going to call him as our next pastor, then the changes begin. Then you find out what you've really got. Now, they tell us that it takes somewhere from a year to a year, or 1 month to a month and a half for every year the pastor has served to be able to find a new pastor. So if I were, and I'm not doing this, but if I were walk in here today and say, I'm resigning, you take 15 times one or one and a half, and that's how long it would normally take to find a pastor to replace. Just statistics tell us this over and over. The interim period is a difficult time for the church because it's in limbo. Who is the leader? Who's going to be the leader? Our kids went to a church in Virginia, and when they moved, they visited several churches, and two of them did not have pastors. They loved the church. But they said, we don't want to join a church without knowing who the pastor is going to be. And so they held off on that. Now, let me say this, because I don't want anybody to misunderstand. I'm not saying pastor search committee is the wrong way to go. I'm not saying there's anything biblically wrong with it. I'm not saying it's of the devil by any means. In most situations, that's what's required. That's just the way it works. It's the way it needs to work. But when you know something is coming in the future, when there is a plan, you can plan for the future. You can deal with transition instead of letting last-minute transition deal with you. And so what I want to do for the rest of our time, and now that's been the introduction, is to show you an example of how this works using Timothy and Paul, or Paul and Timothy. In 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 2, Paul says, "What you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, commit to faithful men who will be able to teach others also." Now, we can apply this in many ways. We can apply this across the church. We ought to be teaching younger adults, youth, children, so that they can, and this is talking about specifically men, people that are faithful, so that they can teach, because you do realize the teaching ministry of the church is far beyond the individual ministers. So we ought to be raising up people in the church so that they can teach God's word. But at the same time, this applies very well to leadership. So what I see are three steps here, three steps of a transition. Number one is the parenting. Paul says in 1 Timothy 1:2, as he writes, he says he's writing to Timothy. Look what he says, "My true son in the faith." To Timothy, my true son in the faith. Now, this process is important because, let me tell you, anybody that's been to seminary and coming out thinking that they're totally prepared for ministry is sadly mistaken. The seminary trains you for a lot of things, but seminary is not a pastor's all in all. I mean, I've seen some duds come out of seminary, okay? While I was in seminary, I looked at some guys and went, why on earth are you here? And sometimes it was because mama called them and daddy sent them. It's better to be called by God, okay? So seminary's not the all in all. And I assure you, once a minister gets into the local church, they find out that they're not prepared for things that they thought they would be prepared for. I had a pastor one time that I was working registration at the seminary for a new semester, and he was one of our former pastors in Cleveland. And all of a sudden, I look up, and he's standing there, and he's quite a bit older than I am. I said, what are you doing here? He said, well, I'm registering for classes. Well, I thought he had a seminary degree, and he didn't. But I looked, and I said, well, you're pastoring, and you're going through the education department. And he said, yeah, I know how to preach. I don't know how to run a church. And so he said, this is the area I need, and this is what I'm going to do. Because he realized that in being prepared to preach, it doesn't prepare you to necessarily pastor. So that's why we need this parenting relationship, and we see it between Paul and Timothy. There's much to learn as a minister lifts his face from a textbook and starts staring into a local church. It's very different. And so there needs to be that walking through that process. It takes time, it takes patience, it takes guidance, it takes encouragement, it takes caution, and it takes love. But the goal is that at some point, the parenting leader can say to the local church, much like Paul said to the church at Philippi when he's talking about Timothy, and it's in Philippians chapter 2, verse 20 to 22. He says, for I have no one else like-minded who will genuinely care about your interest. All seek their own interest, not those of Jesus Christ. But you know his proven character because he has served with me in the gospel ministry like a son with a father. He says, you know this guy. You've seen him. You've seen him working with me. You've seen what he is. So there's not as much hidden. Now, there might be some things you don't necessarily like about him. Timothy was different from Paul. But he says, you know him. You say, well, how does that play out today in churches? Well, many of you will know the name Ronnie Floyd. Been the pastor in Arkansas at Springfield, Arkansas for years. They have multiple campuses now. He was just called as the executive director of the executive committee for the Southern Baptist Convention. Now, he's been in that church for, I don't know, 30 years or something like that. So he accepted that. Now that church doesn't have a pastor. Guess what? Their executive board just recommended that their church call his son Nick to be the senior pastor. Nick is, he was born in that church. He's grown up in that, well, yeah, he might have been a baby when they moved there, but he grew up in that church. He's been discipled in that church. He felt the call to ministry. He was saved in that church. He felt the call to ministry in that church. He's been ministering. He's been a staff campus pastor at another locate, one of their secondary locations. And so now they say, hey, we're going to move him into the senior pastor role. And the church was pleased with that. And that's taking place as we speak. Johnny Hunt. He's got daughters. He doesn't have a son. Johnny has just taken a position with the North American Mission Board. So he's been at First Baptist Woodstock, an amazing church, for years. And he's kind of working part-time in both places now, but he found a pastor that was just, they had a kindred spirit. He was there in Georgia at another church, and he's watched and he's observed. And so they've brought that guy by the name of Jeremy Morton on staff, and they're co-pastors now, and Johnny's in the process of transitioning out. So there are two churches that are in the midst of it. And you look at that and you go, yeah, but Pastor, those are a lot bigger churches than we are. Yeah, they are. I can tell you of a church down in Cleburne, Larry York has done the exact same thing with a young man by the name of Adam Matthews, and I've seen a beautiful, I wish I could spend the time to tell you the beauty of what I've seen there, but it has been amazing in that church. There's Emmanuel Baptist Church that, and by the way, that church is close to our size, and then there's Emmanuel Baptist Church in Weatherford where Gary Ward was pastor, and now he's still there. He's an associate, and the new pastor is Will Becknell. And so he has raised him up. And actually in that one, Will was in the church before Gary was. But then they, as they started serving together, it was just a natural process. So we see this parenting role. We see it in Timothy and Paul. We see it in other churches that we know of. But there has to be a time when that parenting role changes. And that takes us to the second point, and that is a pace setter role. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 10 through 11, it says, "But you have followed my teaching, my conduct, purpose, faith, patience, love, and endurance, along with the persecutions and sufferings that came to me in Antioch and Iconium and Lystra. What persecutions I endured, and yet the Lord rescued me from them all." See, when I came out of seminary, I went into a church, and I knew the pastor, and we went to Virginia and served on staff there, and I had the privilege of watching a pastor and seeing how he did it. Now, he did some things that when I looked at it, I said, I will never do that in my life or in any church. He was human. But there are many other things that I looked at and said, man, he nailed it. And that's the way I want to do it. And so I had that role to look. He wasn't perfect, but he taught me many things. And there were those things that I said, I want to follow that. I want to imitate that because I've seen it and I've seen it work, and I believe it's godly. So why would I not also want to take somebody younger than me and model pastoral ministry? As a matter of fact, I think we ought to be doing that. Shouldn't this be a part of pastoring across the board? Model pastoral ministry for others. Do it by not only word, but by example. Now, does that mean I'm perfect? No. If you want to check on that, check with the staff, check with my wife. They'll be happy to tell you. But see, there are times in ministry, and one of the things as I was looking at this passage in chapter 3, I understand the teachings and the conduct and the purpose, but look what he said, an endurance. There's something about finishing well that we don't see a lot of today in many cases. And he says, along with the persecutions and the sufferings that came to me in these places, what persecutions I endured, so I hung in there, and yet the Lord rescued me from them all. Listen, there are times in ministry you just want to throw the towel in. You say, I'm done. Can't take any more. What about your call? Yeah, he gave me a call, but I'm through with it. Now, I don't understand that mindset, but I know it's out there. I know it's out there more than we'd ever want to admit. What a blessing for a young pastor to be able to look back at a pace setter who kept going and endured even through the hardships. In my 25 years of vocational ministry, I've served on staff with 14 other ministers. 9 are no longer in ministry. Only one of the 9 have retired due to physical issues, had to take early retirement. The rest of them are basically out of ministry. Some of them totally out of ministry. I started getting phone calls from former church members, not here in another church, that said, and they called this staff member by name and said, is he not in ministry anymore? Because all his Facebook posts look like he's in a bar somewhere. And it's true. walked away from ministry. Several of them have done that. There's something about finishing well. In 2016, the SBC Facts and Trends magazine reported of pastors, 84% say they are on call 24 hours a day. That doesn't surprise anybody. 80% expect conflict in their church. Reality of the world. 54% find the role of pastor frequently overwhelming. Listen, I figured out a long time ago, I can't do this without God. It is overwhelming. It's a bigger task than any of us can take. 53% are often concerned about their family's financial security. 48% often feel the demands of ministry are more than they can handle. 21% say their church has unrealistic expectations of them. Oh, surely not. Then 250 pastors, listen to this, 250 pastors leave ministry every month. Wonder why we have a shortage. To face this, ministers, especially young ministers, need a pace setter in their lives so they can look and say, not only did you come up against, and you've taught me all these things, but you've come up against some tough things, and you survived. And you didn't walk away from God, and God didn't walk away from you. And so if you can do it, as goofy as you are, I can do it. We need that. We need those people that we can look to. And so that brings us to the third phase we see in Paul and Timothy. It is that of partnering. In Romans chapter 16, verse 21, Paul writes, Timothy, my co-worker, greets you. Notice the change. He went from a son, and then if you take the text, he was somebody that was watching the pace setter and keeping up with the pace setter, and now he is my co-worker in ministry. What a beautiful progression. For Timothy, son, student, co-worker. For Paul, parent, pace setter, partner. The Bible just lays it out for us. And you said, yeah, but that was just those two guys. Is that it? Well, no. Just so happens that we see the same progression in Paul and Titus. We don't have time to go through all the details, but Paul starts off in Titus chapter 1, verse 4. He writes, to Titus, my true son in the common faith. Heard that somewhere before? Same way he dealt with Timothy. And then he writes three chapters giving Titus personal and pastoral instructions and encouragement as he continues the local work that Paul started in Crete. So we see a biblical picture of church leadership transition. We've got another picture, and I want to leave this one in your mind. Remember the handprints? You know what that is? That's a baton. Baton's used in a relay race. And when they do a relay race, they don't do it by saying, okay, we've got these four or however many guys it is, we've got these four runners, and so you run one and we'll time you, and you run one and we'll time you, and you run and we'll time, and they each take their turns running, and then they add them up and average them. They don't do that. Now, in a relay race, all the guys are out there at the same time. Now, they have different legs to run, but there's that process where one race doesn't start and then stop, and then you take and add up scores. In a relay race, there's actually a time that you're running at the same time somebody else is running. Because the guy that starts the race, the guy that's got the baton in his hand, he makes that lap. I'm not a runner. You can kind of tell that. Somebody with, how many, do they run one full lap? Okay. One full lap. So they run a full lap, and then the next guy is up here, and they're going to hand that baton off to them. But you know what happens? He doesn't run up there and stop and go, take it and run. No, they're running at the same time. And so number two begins to run, and he's reaching back, and number one's coming up on him, and he hands that baton off, and that race is continued. And there's at a point where he makes his round, and he hands that baton off to the next guy, and that happens about four times. the place that you got to be careful there is not the running, it's the handoff. Because you don't want to drop that baton. If you drop the baton, you're going to lose the race. And so there's that time of transition, that time of handoff that is critical to win the race. And that's what I see in the idea of minister-pastor transition for the church. So that the race doesn't stop. So that there's not a dead time. So there's not a downtime. So that we keep running. And we keep moving and the church keeps moving ahead. Listen, when I left Cave Spring Baptist, my heart's desire was not for that church to go through a downtime. My heart's desire was for that church to keep soaring. I wish, and it hurts my heart today to see what's happened in many cases there, because they're a fraction of the size they used to be. Because my desire was to see the ministries grow and grow and grow and be bigger than ever. Because it's about the end prize, not the intermediate things. So there's this transition. Leadership transition in the church. You say, well, this is all great information, but how does it apply to our church? What does it look like here? What do you want us to do with this stuff, Pastor? You've dumped this stuff on us today. Some of you have been scratching your head for a week. I'm amazed at how few people really ask any questions after last week, but you're going, what do you want us to do with this? Well, the first thing I want you to do is pray. Because no matter how good of a plan we put together, if God's Holy Spirit isn't leading and guiding in all of us, it won't work. Prayer ought to begin every bit of it and saturate every bit of it. What is the future for this church? I don't know. Listen, because God's mind is bigger than our minds. God's ways are different from our ways. So what it's going to look like in the years ahead, I don't have a clue, and none of you have a clue. And if you got an idea for it, please put it down and leave it alone, because we want it to be bigger than that. We want it to be God's plan. So pray. Secondly, you can make two meetings today. This one and tonight at 5:00 over in the First Family Center. Because at that time, we're going to present to you the details of what I've laid a biblical foundation for. And we're going to allow you some time. We're going to give some explanation. And we're going to tell you the details of who we're talking about and what we're talking about and how that's going to look. We're going to answer your questions. We're going to give you an opportunity to ask questions. And we're going to spend however much time we need to deal on that, with this. And then, you're not going to vote tonight. When's the last time you went to a business meeting and they didn't ask you to vote? Then, once that's finished, next Sunday, as we gather back in here for worship, we will complete the worship service, and at the end of the service, we will have a time for you to say, as a church, by ballot, I approve this or I don't approve this. You still have the final say. That's the unique, great thing about being an autonomous, congregational-ruled church. And so that's what's going to happen. You say, well, I still don't have enough information. I hope you don't, because that'll drive you to being here tonight. Because people don't normally say, I just can't wait to get to a business meeting. So this is going to be a business meeting filled with information. I encourage you to pray. Pray tonight. Pray this afternoon. Be ready to ask questions. Be ready to listen with an open heart and an open mind. And to be able to take what we will be presenting and say, how does this, does this look like the biblical model that God's given us through the work of Paul and Timothy and Paul and Titus?